No. Well, needless to say, that was nuts and awesome and crazy good. So we're here because after that amazing performance by Jared and the band, we're here to talk to the man himself about his Blackstar amplifier, his combo amp in particular, and all things Jared James Nichols, if we can. So let me bring on our guest, Jared. What is up?
Ben, you legend. I love you. I'm so glad to be here, man.
Likewise.
Yeah.
So let's talk about that performance. That was awesome. Obviously, we can all agree, those that are watching. If you're in the chat, please let us know. We're looking at the chat. So whatever you say that's awesome, myself and Jared will see it. And we'll even throw it up on the screen in the middle of this conversation. So with that being said, let's talk first. You have a bass player and a drummer. Who are they, for those that don't know?
Okay, so the drummer, his name is Dennis Holm. He's from Sweden originally. We've been playing together. Honestly, man, I moved to Los Angeles when I was 21. So that would have been in late 2010. He was one of the first guys I met, and we've been playing ever since. He now lives in Nashville, so we've stayed close. But yeah, he's just a burning drummer, and we've come up together, and it's awesome. And who's on bass is Clark Singleton. He actually lives in Nashville as well. He's a friend of ours that we met early on. We probably met him in 2012. He was playing with a different band. And Dennis and I both said, man, one day we're going to play with Clark and we're going to make music. And once the pandemic hit, the bass player that we were running with, his name's Baron Fox, great player, great guy. He was in California. Dennis was here. Clark was here. So we started making music, and it just started to make sense that we would all kind of start playing together. Next thing you know, Clark's on tour with us and we're just rocking.
Very cool. Yeah. Cause it's funny. I didn't get to talk to them when I met them about how they got to know you and whatnot. So one thing I do want to address is, and I'm sure you're already like, oh, here it comes, but we were supposed to do this obviously a month or so ago. And for the fans that were tuned in, realized we had to postpone it for a very valid reason, mind you. This was Jared was not doing the diva thing. It's not that. It was a legitimate thing. So if you don't mind, can you explain why we had to wait a little bit longer to have this moment with you?
Absolutely. Even though I'm so ashamed to say that this happened.
Don't even be a little bit, really.
So check this out. So we were with you in New York City. We filmed the performance. Everything was great. I was in the middle of a tour with Blackstone Cherry across America. We found ourselves in Florida. I play an awesome set in Florida. Get off stage, sweating bullets. All right, let's get out of here. I go to grab my amp head. It was in a case. And now the case was this really janky, like 70s road case, right? And it has a single handle on the top. And I went, and now I'm going to demonstrate. I go to pick it up, right? And I pick it up, and I come up like that. And I felt a pop in my elbow. And I went, what was that? And I thought that maybe I had a cramp in my elbow because I could still move my fingers. Everything was good. Go up to my tour manager. I said, hey, man, I think we need to pop my elbow back into place. And he goes, does it hurt? I said, no, it's fine. And then he felt my arm. He goes, man, we better go get it checked out. Turns out I had some stress fractures on the back of my humerus bone, probably from like working out or just life in general. I popped a little chunk of the bone off.
Oh no. Oh no.
Yeah. Right above the elbow. So a lot of people were saying, man, how did you do that? The reality is there was already some damage there, and just, it was the heaviest case we had. And of course, when I went to go grab it, this twist, it's almost like I just hit it the right way and it just popped. So there I am in Florida for 2 days waiting to get a surgery so they can fix it. Now I'm the bionic man. Literally, I have a cut down my arm. I have a plate in there on the bone with screws. But the best part, Ben, is the fact that everything's good. I can play. Every day it's getting better. But the worst part was I had to cancel the tour. I had to cancel our giveaway and Q&A. And it was just crazy, man. I can't believe it happened, but I'm so thankful that it wasn't any worse. But yeah,
was when you hurt yourself, I originally was like, oh no, this is going to be really bad. And then I'm seeing you post things about how you're it's the wildest thing. You're just back in the gym and you're back playing guitar and you don't sound any worse or different and you're lifting weights. At first I was like, this guy is not taking his doctor's advice. This is so ill-advised. What is he doing? But yeah, you came out on the other side, as they say, and you're looking good. You clearly are also playing well, not even just from that, but if you just, for anyone who's on his socials, just watch him. He's still got it. You'd never know. So God bless you, man. That's awesome.
Thanks, man. I'm very grateful and I'm very lucky it wasn't any worse, because at the end of the day, it was only really the bone. I didn't have to work on the ligaments or the muscles or anything. So like, I got lucky, Ben. It could have been a lot worse. And at the end of the day, like, now I'm just shooting for 2022. You know, I'll get the holidays over with. And by then, look out, man. I'm going to be like that movie Rookie of the Year. Do you remember that one? Where he was like, that's going to be me with
that. That's our generation of that movie. Like, I know that movie. But there are people who are probably too old or too young to even remember that movie.
I think you're right. But
now you know it's worth it to pay extra for roadies, because that's their job. If they break an arm, a tour does not go kaput. So there you go. Lesson learned, as they say.
Absolutely, man.
So like I said, glad you're feeling so much better. Let's talk about the songs we just heard. They're from your new EP, Shadow Dancer. We heard the song Bad Roots. We heard the song Shadow Dancer, from the title of the song, and Skin and Bone, not necessarily in that order. But first, I want to talk about the songs as they are and the album. And then I do want to point out the guitars you were playing for a brief moment, the first two at least.
Sure.
So talk about the album. Tell us about, where does the title come from, Shadow Dancer? Where do the songs come from? What's the inspiration?
Yeah. So basically, while I was home, I was writing a ton of new material. And I knew that I had to get some music out. And it's so cool. I moved to Nashville at the end of 2019, and I just hit this kind of new vein for like writing and collaborating with different people. I found myself, long story short, I found myself and Clark and Dennis in a studio here in Nashville called Blackbird it would have been April of this year. And we were in there with this producer, Eddie Spear, younger English guy who's just totally, totally awesome. Not afraid to push it, kind of like myself. So we became fast friends, and I had a collection of tunes, and we picked these three along with one other track to make this EP. So when we went in the studio, we said, we need to make this feel kind of like the menu for a live show. So what you hear on the EP now, if you were to listen to what you had just played live from Smash Studios when we were there a few weeks ago to what you hear on the EP, you'll notice a lot of similarities. When we went into the studio, we tracked it as a live band. At first, I was even singing when I was playing, but I was going so crazy on the guitar that I was like, you know what? I'll sing over it. But minimal overdubs, we recorded to tape. Everything was done in 1 to 3 takes. All of the solos were cut live with the band. Everything was done in a way, and it's not only about being from, you know, the old school, but we just did it in a way of musicians playing, interacting in a room. And as far as the track, Shadow Dancer being the title track, it was so weird because that was one of the late bloomers. I had that riff forever. And I would sit at home and I would play it. And when I brought it into the studio, Eddie, the producer, was like, what's that? Let's do something with that. So we built that up in the studio, and it became something that was just so kind of mystical. And it was almost like it was just one of those tracks that it was a sleeper. And Skin and Bone, Bad Roots, those were written just to be played live. And when we got in the studio, it was so cool because, you know, being off the road for so long due to the pandemic, it felt like being in the studio, I had something to prove. So those songs were written with a lot of energy, a lot of gusto.
You can see and hear it. And I got to say, I didn't know the story about, you said it was Shadow Dancer, the one you wrote in the studio, which is wild that you had just a little riff, which I'm assuming is the opening riff you had.
Mm-hmm.
And you simply developed that into what we heard today. And it sounds like the kind of song, like, and I'm giving you a lot of credence with this, like a kind of Stairway to Heaven, where it sounds like it was such a huge project that took years to develop, and you're like, yeah, I just had a riff and we built it in the studio, and I'm giving you credit because it sounds incredibly impressive as far as composition is concerned. And obviously you're rocking the hell out of it as well. And the effects on it are very cool. Speaking of, what are the effects you're using, especially on that riff?
Okay, so check this out. That, like to go back to that, that one like kind of just fell out. Like all of a sudden it started to write itself. I don't know. There's moments with everything in life where you have this writer's block and then all of a sudden it just comes out. Shadow Dancer was that for me. So check out this chain. I had my Blackstar Artisan 100 watt, right? Linked together with my signature amp, the JJN20. So I had those two, like a wet, dry. So that was the main rig of this whole EP. And then we fed the guitar into a rotating Leslie cabinet, like an old Leslie cabinet. So we got that really cool kind of, that rotary sound. Then we put it through, this sounds crazy, we put it through a Univibe, which gave it even more of a pulse and like a presence. It's very slow. Think like a Robin Trower, that kind of sound, right? And then The craziest thing, Eddie had an old Univox Super Fuzz, which is like some random fuzz. And the thing,
I know what you're talking about though.
Yeah, the thing barely worked and it was screaming, right? And it was so loud and it was so shrill. But what we found is that if I doubled that, after I'd put the Leslie on, just a little bit, volume almost all the way off, it gave it this really edgy kind of saturated tone for that riff. So when you really listen to it, you almost hear it. It almost feels lush underneath due to the Univibe, the Leslie. And then you have this like Univox, and that's what you're hearing for the solo too. And that solo is doubled. It's my Sam Ash fuzz box with the Univox. And if you listen to that solo, there's not a lot going on. It's just so open and big. And it's insane because I'm playing that melody basically up two octaves, right? Or one octave. And then I start to double it. I start to run around it. But it's kind of a haunting thing and it's really cool.
Yeah, man. It's like when you listen to songs from Once Upon a Time, you go, all right, it's all been done. Can you still make that kind of retro classic rock sound, but modern? And you managed to figure it out with that track. It sounds like if you played it for someone, you'd be like, oh yeah, this is off of, this is a Hendrix track that never got released. It's a posthumous track, but no, alas, you wrote yourself a song and it's a great track. And for all of those that haven't listened to the album outside of watching the live performance there, it's all over Where Music is available, both YouTube and I recommend purchasing the music because that's always great to support your artists. Let's move on. We've only got so much time and I've got a bunch of questions to ask. So, but that's fascinating. That's so cool about where these songs came from and whatnot. But let's talk about Blackstar. We're here because of Blackstar. The least we can do is discuss about these awesome amps. So that being said, for those that don't know, Blackstar is a relatively new amp company. They've been around now basically 15 plus or minus years, I would say, give or take. And you seem to have been using them almost since day one. So where did that relationship start with them where you found these amps? Granted, there are amp companies galore, but you gravitated towards this company. And lo and behold, you have not just an amp stack of your own, but you now have a combo. So how did it go from point A or from A to Z, if you will?
So when I was like everyone else growing up, I was trying everything. I was trying every amp combination I could. It was all about the pursuit. Like, what does that sound like? What does this sound like? So before Blackstar, whatever I could get my hands on, I'd play through. When I moved to Los Angeles in, like I'd said, the end of 2010, beginning of 2011, I started to go to this studio called Swing House. And Swing House was, I believe, truly one of the first places in America to have all of the Blackstars. So they had all the Artisans. They had the HT, which was the early versions of them. I remember like they had the Club 50 and they had all of these different amplifiers. And when I first went there, I didn't even own an amp at the time. I had my guitar, I had my Les Paul, and I walked into a room and I said, what is that? So I said, let me try it. I didn't have any effects pedals on me or anything. Plugged straight into it. I go to the overdrive channel and I loved what I heard. It was the perfect mix to me of what I loved about that British, you know, that overdriven Marshall thing that I was so used to, which was really punchy, really barky. But there was also a chime when I rolled back on my volume. And being a fingerstyle player, I don't use picks, so I couldn't have something that was too overdriven, too saturated. I needed something articulate, and I found it right away in that Blackstar. So I started to talk to Phil at Swing House, and I said, hey, man, I really want to try and use some of these at a gig. So I started using them at a gig. I'd borrow them, and I loved it. I would plug straight into them, and I did that for years. And what's funny about that is I feel like I grew up and I started to grow my career right alongside as Blackstar was getting into America. So every year, like a new amp would come out, or, you know, whether I remember I was touring with Zakk Wylde and I had the Artist 30s, all of these new variations would come out. And I was like, yeah, let me play them on tour, until the point where it would have been 2019 where I got my signature model. And it's really great because Blackstar has always, always taken care of me. Korg as well, where I would be on tour anywhere and I'd say, okay, I'm going to be at this festival. They would send me an amp. Or if it was like, I'm going to Europe for 3 months, amps would be there when I was there. You know, everything was always set up. And
that's some luxury treatment right there.
Yeah. I just couldn't believe it. It was such a beautiful thing. And I've played all around the world with a Blackstar behind me. And I've never thought to myself once, and I truly mean this, I've never thought to myself once, like, oh man, you know, like, I'm not inspired. It's like, whenever I plug into a Blackstar, it gives me everything I need to go, whether it's in the studio or whether it's live, and just go out there and crush it.
Well, it sounds great. And I love the fact that you brought up these amps are very articulate. And I think that's an interesting way to describe the sound, that you can get that overdriven British rock tone. But for someone like you and the few others that are fingerstyle guitar players, amongst the many of myself and others that use a pick, you really, and you can hear it in your playing, you can hear the subtle nuances of when you're hitting the notes or the string softly, or you're attacking it, or you're smacking it, which, again, I've met you in person and I can't believe your fingertips aren't just decimated or even just fully calloused. It's remarkable. They will do studies on your fingers one day. So all that being said, so now you've, this is your relationship with Blackstar. You were at one point just an artist playing their amps. And then one day the call, I don't know if it was you to them or vice versa, suddenly it's, hey, we should make a signature amp for you. And I remember when they unveiled it in the middle of the front of the NAMM show, it was like under just some cloth and they just went, whoosh, and there's your amp. So I have a lot of questions about both the stack and the combo. So I'll just throw them all out there. Or maybe you'll cover them all. But first of all, how did this relationship start where you were making amps alongside of Blackstar? Two, assuming that the stack is more or less the same as the combo, except one's a stack, one's a combo, why Green Tolex?
Mm-hmm.
And what were specific things you requested to be in your Blackstar amp that, although you love their line of amps, you wanted this to be signature, literally and figuratively, to your sound?
Totally. Okay, the first question that's very easy to answer is, why green? It's for the British Racing Green. It was all about, it was like my tip of the hat to Blackstar, to British amps. Because when I was thinking about it, I remember we were on tour and I was like, what color? Because they said I could pick a color. And I wanted it to look vintage. I wanted it to feel like something that's always been there, but it was still striking, current and modern. And I started to think about it and I was like, man, I like a green. And I started to look like just on my phone and backstage. And I was like, man, British Racing Green is pretty cool because it's kind of a tough green. You know, it has its own kind of attitude towards it. So that was the first thing. That was my British ode to Blackstar. And then, as far as why did I really basically get to the point with this amp where I said, this is what I need. This is what has to be in it. It was really because of the fact, using all these Blackstars over the years, I knew exactly what I loved about each one. There were some models that I would say, man, the clean channel on the Artist 30 is the best clean channel I've ever used. And when I went to the distorted channel, I was like, it was better if I turned it this way. Or, you know, I knew all of these different things. And I remember we were on tour in England and they said, Jared, you're going to go to Blackstar. Today you have a day off. And then you have a show tonight, but you're going to go there and you're going to basically build the amp of your dreams. So me and my bandmates roll into Blackstar in Northampton in the UK. And we go into this room and there's a huge whiteboard and there's a bunch of parts and speakers everywhere. And they said, okay, let's start from the top. So we basically wrote out every single thing I wanted in the amp. And I remember I go, okay, so I really, you know, I love the fact that the artisan breaks up here. And they would say, okay. And they'd write something down. Okay, we can do that. And I remember it would get to the point where we were trying the amp and they would be swapping out capacitors. And it would be which ones feel better, which ones feel, you know, more natural to the way that you play. So we dug deep and
when you're going into capacitors, you're getting really granular.
Yeah. And capacitors, speakers, the mismatched speakers in that, in the little mini stack, everything was done for a reason. And I basically said to them, guys, I want to have, whether it's the stack or the head, I want to be able to carry this anywhere in the world. I want to be able to plug in and have my tone. And that's what we figured out.
So that's awesome. I didn't realize it was, because I've never, obviously, not yet at least, I've never been part of the build something from scratch process with a product. So I know some people probably are the ones that are like, just put my name on it, we're good. And then there's some people who are like, I like this, but just make it have this bridge. And then there are people like you where they literally nuts and bolts with that kind of project. So for the gear nerds like myself and others, you got a Blackstar amp. What tubes, what speaker are we talking about for those that have never heard this amp or haven't physically been near one yet?
Totally. So tubes, EL84s. I don't know what it is. I've tried everything. The 6L6s, every single combination, the EL84s for me are the ones. It was like, there's some way that I play. I don't know if it's the attack that it gives me, the way that they make the chords and the notes, single notes bloom. That was huge for me. And then as far as the speakers, so we have a Celestion, a V-type speaker, which is very neutral, very, it's an easy speaker to work with every style. But then we have this GT75, which is kind of been known to be a very sharp, high mid-range speaker. I'm telling you though, these two speakers together, they punch, and there's something about them. And I always said, when I play guitar, whether it's with the band, in the studio, if I'm guesting on something, I want to be able to pop out of the mix. Having the combination of that V-type speaker and that GT75, I know this is so nerdy, but I could—
Talking to a nerd.
Yeah, so I could be playing with someone that's playing through a 50 or 100 watt mic'd up. I remember I was doing a gig. It was with everyone at Gibson. We were at the NAMM show, and it was Peter Frampton and Billy Gibbons and Richie Faulkner and a ton of amazing.
I think the shorter list was who wasn't there, because yes, it seemed like everybody was there.
And I remember, man, I was plugged into the JJN 20, and everything was mic'd up. And Billy Gibbons looked at me and he goes, like, take a solo. And I was like, oh, here we go. And I laid into it and it was right there. It was like, and I knew at that moment, I was like, man, my tone's sticking out. It's not too safe. It had something to it that really, really stood out in the mix. And it was exciting.
And it seems to work really well with pedals, because we're talking as if you're just guitar amp in. And it's, I've heard that, obviously, and it sounds great. But for those that have a pedal board that they will not play a gig without one, how does it work with pedals? Because you're a pedal board guy yourself.
Yeah, now I am. I wrote a bunch of songs with effects, and now I'm a pedal board guy. It's great. There's a really great platform. Basically, if you wanted to take this amp, you could go straight into channel one into the first voicing, because each channel has two different voicings. You go into that first channel and you have your cleanest pedal platform you'd ever need. As well as if you want to push it using the blues power channel, you can really start to saturate the tone and stack using your pedals. So it's very user friendly. There's a lot of amplifiers that I've used in the past that are not pedal friendly. And it's kind of a buzzkill because you're like, man, I love the way this amp sounds. I wish that I could stack it with my favorite overdrives or, you know, put a fuzz on it. With this amp, it just feels like it's more of a Swiss Army knife where you can go, I could put anything in front of this amp or in the effects loop. You know, I was even doing things in the studio where I had a Echoplex pedal. I put it in the effects loop. And there was all of these different combinations that I could keep pushing the tone. And the amp kept taking it, which was the coolest part. I didn't have to worry about it where it's like, oh man, is this going to work? It was like everything I'd put in front of it, whether it was a, you know, obviously the Sam Ash fuzz box or an Echoplex or Univibes or running it with a Leslie, it worked flawlessly with every combination.
Yeah, I mean, the way you're describing this, and may he rest in peace, is very much like Van Halen, where you were very integral to making this amp do anything and everything, but also be versatile. But like you said, have dedicated channels that by themselves do everything you need. If you didn't touch a pedal, if you didn't have anything except a guitar, you'd be golden. But it is pedal friendly. And that's very much similar to like any of the 5150s, but obviously this amp is way more affordable and is definitely catered, right as we speak, and correct me if I'm wrong, it's definitely catered towards a rock kind of tone, where if you want the overdrive. But I would love to see someone prove me wrong that they're a metal guy and they're making their sound awesome through one of your amps. Also, it'd be nice to have a really gorgeous looking green amplifier on stage if you're in a metal band. So
totally,
I think it's fantastic that you've made this amp. And it's not just you slapping your name on it, that there's a lot of care and nuance put into it, that not only is it great for just you, but it's great for anybody who decides to pick up this amp, which is the most important thing, or else who's going to buy it?
Whether it's these amps or Old Glory or Gold Glory, everything that I've done that I want to put my name on, it's a product that truly I've put every ounce of everything I have into it to say, how am I going to make this not only a great product, but how am I going to put a piece of me into this? And I feel like truly with this amp, it's when I got the final product, it was lights out, man. It was perfect. And I was so happy with the way it sounded, with the way it resonated. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, I've become a fan of Blackstar too. I've got my Stereo 10 right here that I've been playing almost all the time. I say almost all the time because sometimes I need to eat and sometimes I have to spend time with my wife. But when I'm not doing either of those things, it's this. They did not pay me to say this. I am just proud to have it and it plays great. So I do want to go back to the video because we've talked about the amp and I just want to gloss over two of the guitars. I'd say we'd talk about your signature amp, but we literally did an entire hour on a live stream, which if you all are following us on Facebook or YouTube, just look up Jared James Nichols and you'll find the previous interview we've done. So we'll leave that for that. However, you had a gorgeous red Gibson and a gorgeous gold Gibson. What are the stories behind those? Because you had, and then obviously the third one's your signature guitar, but let's talk about the red one. And I definitely want to talk about that gold top because I know some of that story, but the audience may not know.
Yeah. So the red Les Paul that I was playing, I got from a really great friend of mine. His name's Charlie Daughtry. He runs the website. I'm sure a lot of people have seen it. It's called the Les Paul Forum.
He's an
old school collector. He has a ton of vintage Gibsons. I mean, everything from Bursts to old Firebirds, Specials, Juniors. I mean, he's got everything. And I met him a few years back. And before that, I really hadn't had any access to the vintage, to the really old stuff, all the golden era, 50s Les Pauls. And I was hanging out with Charlie, and he actually bought that guitar off of the original owner. It came from the original owner's family. He had passed, and his family put up that guitar for sale, and Charlie got it. And I remember I was instantly hooked on it. It's a 1953 all original gold top, but it was painted over red. And that the paint that it was painted over with, it was probably done, I don't know when, I don't think Charlie knows when, probably in the mid 60s. So it's a really, really old overspray. And I knew it immediately when I picked that guitar up. It was just magic. The funny thing is,
I hope you play into that so hard that you start scraping the finish, and then there's just gold stripes, like almost like a tiger claw that you end up seeing on that in like 20, 30 years, God willing.
So it'll happen.
I'm looking forward to
it. I keep playing it, man. I mean, as long as I'm still around to play it, that thing is, it's already like every month you can start to see the red go away and it's gold. And then underneath the gold is flame.
Ooh. So you have like
this.
Okay.
Amazing three version. You know what I mean?
It's one of those things, like, you know, when you see those videos of people doing a time lapse of like growing their facial hair or getting older, I kind of want to see the time lapse of that Les Paul. I know we're just about at the end. Tell us about the gold top, and then I want to make sure we point to people where they can get the guitar amp, as well as just announce who won their own Blackstar Fly 3.
Nice.
So talk about this gold top, and we'll jump into those other things.
Okay, so the gold top, actually, I was on Instagram probably about 8 months ago, and I got a message from a guy that had tagged me in some stuff of him playing before. And he said, "Hey, Jared, I know you love old Les Pauls." He said, "Check out this old Les Paul that I found after a tornado in my hometown." And he sends me this picture, and I knew exactly what it was. It was the body, everything complete besides the neck, of a 1952 gold top. And the thing looked just ravaged. So I hit him back and I said, "Man, what's the story on this?" And he basically said, in 2013, there was a crazy tornado in his hometown. The guitar was found in the rubble. The original owner was, he was passed at this point, but his daughter had the guitar. She had claimed it for insurance, and she gave my buddy this guitar and said, "Hey, hang it on your wall." And now this is one of the first Les Pauls that has ever been made due to the pickups. You know, you can tell there's certain things, the thickness of the body. It was basically one of the first 100. And I hit him up. I said, "Hey, man, not to be too forward, but can I buy this guitar?" And he said, "Man, I didn't buy this guitar. I'm not going to have you buy this guitar." He said, "I am going to give this to you."
I wish. Couldn't believe that.
And then I send it to my friend in Pennsylvania, JW Restoration. And I said, "Joel, this guitar, I know there's a song left in it. Can you build a neck?" And he sourced all 50s spec plastics. We got the tuners, everything that was missing from 1952 went back on this guitar. He built a neck. Insane. Insane. One of, hands down, one of the best sounding and playing Les Pauls I've ever played.
And I can proudly say I can attest to that, because one, I happen to hear all those, I hear you play that guitar live. That's one. Two, you were very gracious enough to at least let me strum it. And it's insane what you pointed out, how it is so acoustically loud, and oh my goodness, does this thing resonate? You strike those strings, you are it's almost rare to feel what you're playing. This one is, it doesn't hide it. It might as well just be made of plastic. That's how it feels. But oh boy, does that tone rock so hard. It's such a great guitar. And did you say the name of the guitar appropriately enough?
So after everything that this guitar has been through, I thought the best scenario is we just name it truly as Dorothy, you know, from the Wizard of Oz, because this thing survived a tornado.
It went
through hell and back, and now it has a forever home with me, and I will play that guitar as long as I can. But the reality is, man, there's something about that thing that's really striking and special. And I don't care if you're just hearing guitar for the first time or not into guitar, or you're like my friends, Joe Bonamassa or Charlie, and they hear it and they go, "Wow, that's a guitar." You know what I mean?
You told me Joe is thinking about that guitar, and you're like, not happening, buddy.
Dude, he I would never. Yeah. I brought it to Joe. We were smoking cigars and I said, "Check this thing out." And he hit a chord on it, unplugged. And he goes, "Okay." You know? And then his tour manager was with us and he goes, yeah, you know, Joe loves that guitar. And I was like, do you think he really liked it? And he's like, are you kidding me? He's like, dude, he loved it. So it's that thing packs a punch.
Yeah, it does. It really does. So, and what we just learned is if you have good friends, be good to them, because miracles like this can happen where someone just gives you a guitar and another person fixes you the guitar and you just get to play it. So just be kind to everybody.
Yes. I'll never forget my friend TJ, who gave me the guitar. He said, hey man, let this be a lesson. Every time you play this guitar, remember there's still really good people that it's not all about the money. They just, you know, the music you make on this guitar is going to make me happy.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I want to make sure we did promise two things. First of all, I want to tell people to check out this amazing instrument, your amp, this guy right here on samash.com. Now, some of you might be saying, and I don't completely blame you, unfortunately, going, wait, more on the way? What? Okay, so let me explain this. What happened was we did have a lot of these amps, and we had them specifically for this event to purchase, but a lot of you were so anxious to get this incredible amplifier, we sold out of them before this version of the event. So that's not to say we're not getting these in stock. We are. They're on the way. So what I would recommend is if you want this amp, buy it. Because when this comes back in stock, it's going right out the door, either to someone else who pre-ordered it or to someone who just happened to walk in and it was right there available to them. So just to prove that these amps are sought after, we had them a month ago, a bunch of them, and they're gone. That's how bad people want these amps. So I'm not bluffing. Seriously. This said it was in stock, and now it doesn't, because all of you awesome Jared James Nichols fans said, I need that sound. I trust this thing. It looks gorgeous. And look, it's a gorgeous amp. Here it is up close with that nice tweed front. I wish we had other angles, but you kind of get the picture. And you can lurk if you go and look at all these facts, you can put the whole story behind it. Here's the 20 watt. It's ECC83 preamp, the EL84, as you mentioned, and all the other features. So this is a great amp. Heck, if I need a new amp, it's going to be this one. And I always need a new amp, so it might be this one. But and that being said, it's available at samash.com. Although it doesn't say it's in stock, you could still buy it from us, and we will send it to you as soon as it lands. Basically, it'll come to Sam Ash Music, and it'll go right out the door to your house. Either you can pick it up in store, or you can pick it up, or we could send it to your home. We'll work with you. And so with that, another thing people are anxious for is who got the Blackstar Fly 3. Ooh, that's a tongue twister. Blackstar Fly 3 Bluetooth 3-watt amp. So I'm going to share that screen because that's the only way anyone's going to see. Because guess what? We're going to just pick a winner right now. So check this out. I'm going to share the screen. Let's see if we can see it. Boom. All right, cool. And so look at this. We're going to pick one winner. Not two, not three, just one. And we're going to see who won. Ready? I know neither of us are drummers, but 10.
Oh, 10.
I'm not going to count down. We'll just be patient and see what happens. But in 7 seconds, we're going to see who got this totally awesome wireless Bluetooth amplifier.
Here we go.
Jared, who won it?
Who won it? Jonathan W.
From Sorrento, Florida.
Jonathan, yes. Congratulations, brother.
Yeah, dude. You just got a new amp. So with that in mind, I am going to make sure to get in contact with Jonathan W. Thank you for entering. We appreciate it. And we're going to send that amp to you, well, it's Saturday, so I'm not by this amplifier. So we're going to send it out on Monday. And you're going to be very happy. These, as like any Blackstar amp product, you're always going to be thrilled. So, oh, look at this, is nice. Even though people didn't win, they're like, oh, good. Congrats,
that's
Jonathan.
Very nice.
See, we have a very, look at this. Your fans are supportive. Even if they didn't win, they want other Jared James Nichols fans to feel good about themselves.
That's so sweet. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, you got a good fan base. I mean, the whole chat has been saying, I want to see you when you come to California. You're amazing. You and the guitar are so great. everyone's got, I haven't seen any bad things in the chat, and that's not an invitation to add anything bad to the chat of Jared James Nichols. But I know we both have a night ahead of ourselves, and I'm just grateful for the time I've had with you to chat, as I always do. And before we go, actually, here's one question. I don't know if we asked this in the last interview, but Heather F. asks, who is your biggest inspiration?
Oh, my goodness. That's a great one. I have a few, to be honest. When it comes to the guitar, growing up, Stevie Ray Vaughan, hands down. The intensity, the power, just the whole, everything that he played, like the blues wise, striking to me. But to be honest, the Well runs deep. So, I mean, Stevie was the big one, but then it turned into Leslie West.
Right.
And from the age of probably 17 to now, it's been Leslie. So much so that literally every time I pick up the guitar, it's almost like, it's not like I say, what would Leslie West do? But there's a vocabulary and there's an attitude and a style that I've adopted from him more than anyone. And I'm pretty sure, you know, like when you get older, you start to stick to your old ways. That's how I feel now. Now I'm like, this is the way I want to play. This is how I want to interpret it. So I would have to say, man, Leslie West, rest in peace. I know he was a very close associate of Sam Ash all of his life, but
yeah,
definitely the driving force behind all of it.
So that's, thank you for answering that question. So before we go, let's just do our usual plugs. So on our end, follow Sam Ash Music on socials, follow Jared on Twitter at JJN Music. Everywhere else though, just search Jared James Nichols and you'll find him on Facebook, Instagram. I don't know if you're not on Tinder, at least, because you're a happily married man.
Just once upon a time. No, I'm just kidding.
So, another reminder, although it's not physically in stock right now, you can get Jared's amp from samash.com and other Jared James Nichols paraphernalia, such as his Epiphone guitar. And you can listen and purchase Jared's album, Shadow Dancer, wherever records are sold or wherever music is streamed. And on that last note, what do you want to tell the viewers, whether it's just kind words or do you have anything to promote, anything new you recorded?
Yeah. First off, I'd want to say thanks, everyone, for hanging out. And don't worry about my arm. I'm going to be back in action for 2022 and the end of time, till the end of time. And everything will be good there. As far as new music, besides listening to Shadow Dancer, I recently had a cut. Blues Traveler released a killer all-star record just about a month ago, and they actually covered one of my songs that I wrote.
That's awesome.
I guest on it with them. It's called Keep Your Light On Mama. And you can hear that wherever you stream music. But that whole Blues Traveler record is really cool. And it was an honor to like collaborate with them. So that's a really cool thing. And also just be ready for some more things to drop very soon. Some exclusive videos, content leading up to a record release.
Yeah. So like I said, you may want to follow him on social so you are up to it. And if I'm assuming you have an email list.
Oh yeah, we have an email list. We have that e-blast that goes out. And honestly, if you're on social medias, I'm always on there posting, keeping everything updated. So you will see enough of me, I promise.
Fantastic. Really. I'm at a loss for words because this was so awesome. We got three awesome songs from you to hear and see. You told us everything and anything and everything about this amp and more. As always, it's a blast chatting with you in person or over the web. I'm sure the fans are so grateful for all of this that you've done. If there's a reason that I hope you make another product so we have another reason to chat on the web, or we'll find some reason to chat on the web. But thank you very much, really. And thank everyone for tuning in, supporting Jared, supporting Sam Ash Music. And we hope to see you for the next live stream. Jared, we hope to see you in some way, shape, or form. Great to hear that your arm is back in shape and you're ready to get back on the road ASAP. And I think that's it. And I just wanted to say thank you so much, Jared.
Ben, I consider you a friend and you are a legend. And I love you, buddy. And thanks for having me. And don't worry, there will be more products. There will be more things for us to do in the very near future.
I'm sure of it. So again, man, thanks. And thanks to everybody for watching. And we'll see you next time. Take care.
Yeah. See you guys.